I'm Jason Rissman, and it's now my great pleasure to introduce tonight's guest. Alexa Clay is a storyteller and leading expert on subculture. She is the co-founder of the League of Intrapreneurs, a movement to create change from within big business, and the founder of Wisdom Hackers, an incubator for philosophical inquiry. She was formerly a director at Ashoka, a global nonprofit that invests in social entrepreneurs. Please join me in welcoming Alexa Clay for a conversation about the innovative ideas that arise from unlikely places and how they can be adopted and adapted to provide solutions in the formal economy. Hi.
Hey.
Great to meet you, and thanks for being here and for joining us. So let's start. Just what is a misfit? We're here in San Francisco, in downtown San Francisco, and walking here, it occurred to me maybe I was being passed by a lot of potential misfits.
I had a great misfit conversation in the subway. Yeah,
it happens, right? Yeah. So was it the person that almost ran me over wearing rollerblades and headphones and maybe a blindfold?
Possibly, yeah. Okay. Yeah, I mean, I think the term misfit was really a broad umbrella for us to do research, speaking to both people in the black market and informal economy. So, you know, misfits who are on the margins of our economic systems in many ways. But then also I spent a lot of time doing work with misfits that were in a lot of our mainstream institutions. So maybe these are misfits who camouflage themselves a little bit more, and you can call them intrapreneurs or tempered radicals, or really insider misfits, but, you know, really worked with people that were trying to bring more disruptive ideas and social and environmental concerns into huge organizations. And then my own background too, you know, growing up, I just loved, you know, misfit types of personalities and heroes, from, you know, Henry Thoreau and his hermit experiments to, you know, Black Elk and these revolutionary types of personalities.
Great. So you describe five attributes of misfits: hustle, copy, hack, provoke, and pivot. And these are attributes that might occur in mainstream innovation as well. So what's the differentiation? What makes a misfit different than a mainstream innovator?
Yeah, so we really tried to get outside the usual portrait of, you know, the entrepreneurial innovator as being, you know, the Silicon Valley kind of bro or tech funder kind of personality, to look at hackers and gangsters and pirates, and looking at all these individuals who had an entrepreneurial mindset but were maybe not pure play entrepreneurs, where success for them didn't necessarily look like creating a new startup or a venture per se, but could be bringing a whole new method, or could be about rethinking our entire educational system. And so, you know, that really got us into conversations with interesting types of actors. One of the first conversations I had was with King Tone, who was the former leader of the Latin Kings, a Hispanic street gang. And it was important for us not just to speak to people who were in the black market and informal economy, but were not misfits themselves. So even King Tone had a mandate to transform the culture of the Latin Kings. He was a misfit even within this street organization. And so he inherited leadership and got me really thinking about gang culture in a very different way. The first thing that he said to me was, "Don't call us a gang, call us an organization, because we, you know, we have a brand. We do recruitment and retention like any other organization." And he was really trying to bring a change management program to ask, well, what if we aren't just a street gang that is dependent on criminal activity? What if we are a social movement? What if we're an activist organization like the Black Panthers? And so from that conversation, I really, you know, thought about this idea of hustling very differently. People that were maybe on the wrong side of the law, but were running drug businesses, who had amazing leadership skills, amazing charisma, who knew how to, you know, run these businesses. And so how do we transform some of that hustle from the black market economy and connect them into formal opportunities for employment? And there's a fantastic woman who started an organization called Defy Ventures that's now scaled here in California and San Francisco as well, that really works to connect ex-cons and prison populations with entrepreneurial opportunities and putting them through an accelerator so they can actually recognize the assets that they developed and the skills they developed in the black market economies and repurpose those in the formal economies. And so I really think the term terminology that we used around some of these different misfit characteristics, hack and hustle and copying, they're things that hopefully provide a bridge between the informal economy and the formal economy, you know, that where the Latin king and the tech bro can actually find common ground.
I'm curious to dive deeper into what makes a misfit, and I'll borrow, I think it was King Tone's words from your book, and the stories about him are totally fascinating. I think everyone should check it out. I believe it was him that said, youth only want three things, love, belonging, and opportunity. If you take that away from them, they create it for themselves, and not always in the best way. So when we think about what makes a misfit, is it often the context, the lack of opportunity or lack of a formal structured ecosystem for their entrepreneurial effort, or maybe even that the law maybe hasn't caught up to where it should be?
Yeah, I mean, I think you have people who would maybe identify with a misfit who have grown up extremely privileged, and maybe they have more of a bohemian kind of identity as a misfit. You know, misfits could be, you know, someone like Tesla who, you know, was battling against Edison. But I think within the context of the black market and informal economy, there was definitely people who, you know, were born into poverty, and that was a way of finding pride, that they felt so disenfranchised by the system that this was a way for them to actually express agency in running, you know, in being part of a gang or being part of a successful drug business. On the other hand, it wasn't just, you know, necessarily a scarcity of opportunity. I remember there was one conversation we had with a gangster in India who was a third generation mafioso, essentially. And he tried for a week to work at a call center. He like got some documents forged. And, you know, that was quite a sort of ambitious, you know, high-paying job there. And he just couldn't do it because he lost his underground identity. He lost, you know, his self-respect, and he lost the currency of his peers in doing that. And so I think there are many different reasons for why people become part of underground culture or, you know, start illegal businesses. We just did a great book launch in New York last month, and we had George Young, who inspired Johnny Depp's Blow character, as well as David Victorson, who smuggled 37 tons of marijuana from Colombia to Seattle. And, you know, both of them got into the industry for very different reasons. And in some cases, it is poverty and restricted economic opportunity. For others, it's also just this more sort of fatalistic or anarchistic attitude. So I think it's fairly varied.
Mm-hmm. Could misfits be not just dangerous, but perhaps incredibly dangerous? You think that it's not just maybe a willingness to break the law in some cases, but also bringing a lot of creativity towards it?
Yeah, I mean, I think the biggest thing that we tried to do was not look at misfits with this lens of good or evil. Mm-hmm. And so not seeing them through this idea of, you know, are they dangerous, are they threatening, but actually creating, you know, empathy for people that are, you know, running these types of businesses. So I think you do see incredible hustle, incredible creativity in how some of these organizations get structured. I was so impressed by hacker collectives, for example, groups like Anonymous, who really function on principles of leaderlessness, of decentralization. If we think about what has to shift within the formal economy, so much of the legacy of industrial capitalism that we've inherited is around command and control systems, around standardization, around hierarchies. And a lot of the misfits that we spoke with were going, you know, completely against the tide of that kind of culture. They were building out organizations that were much more self-governing, much more egalitarian in nature. It was fascinating for me to learn about historic pirate cultures and research that they had, you know, constitutions that existed before constitutions existed in Western European countries, mm-hmm. that they had more egalitarian pay structures that you wouldn't even see today in a lot of, you know, Fortune 500 companies where CEO compensation is so high. So in many ways, I think there are a lot of alternative types of ways of organizing that we can learn from these cultures.
Tell us more, what can we learn? I mean, if we think about misfits in some ways predating entrepreneurs, is that before we had structures and laws to support formal economy, this was the hustle, this was how the game was played. So they've always been around. Mm-hmm. Why do they matter today?
Yeah, so one of the most interesting conferences I went when I was just starting to do research for the book was a conference in Philadelphia called Capitalism by Gaslight. And it made me an American patriot in a way, because it was all about these incredible sort of rogues from 19th century America. And, you know, amazing stories of smugglers and confidence men, and just seeing the depth of how, you know, powerful these informal and black market economies were, and actually provided a lot of the groundwork for the Industrial Revolution. You know, learning about patent robbers who stole patents from Western Europe and commercialized them illegally in the U.S. And so I think you've always had this legacy of, you know, in many ways criminal activity predating formal activity, certainly within, you know, if you look at franchising structures, those have, you know, before McDonald's capitalized on them, they were used by mafia and used by gangs. And so, you know, there's definitely a really rich history there. But why does it matter today? Because I think we're entering, you know, there's been talk a lot in the past few weeks about, are we in a post-capitalist moment? In many ways, I think this book is not a blueprint for a new type of economy, but is really about the transitional economy that we're in. And so some of the principles that we try and isolate are really about, you know, so many traditional sectors and industries are dying. You know, the energy system is kind of on the last legs of big oil. Pharmaceutical companies had their like blockbuster drug heyday moment and are now having to reinvent their business models. There's this huge growth of the freelancer economy. Something like by 50% of all Americans will be in the freelancer economy. So that means that we need radically different ways of organizing and thinking about industry and thinking about new types of business models. So it's very much, I think, a transitional philosophy for the moment that we're in.
Great. I'd love to read a quote that I enjoyed and have us reflect on it. Now is the time to look elsewhere for novel ways of rebuilding and reshaping what commitment to old thought has destroyed. Now is the time to look to misfits. So is this something we should actually be encouraging and teaching, and is it possible to do so?
Well, we shouldn't be encouraging everyone to be a criminal, but I think we should definitely encourage a little bit more sort of deviant behavior. And so what does that look like exactly? I think so many old institutions need to find ways of actually bringing, you know, entrepreneurs or people that want to transform those organizations from the inside. They have to be better hosts of these sorts of people. You know, we've just also finished, Ben is here, but this incredible cross-country bus tour where we went to 15 different cities across America, and really focused on local civic innovation and, you know, what's happening in sort of the grassroots underbelly of the U.S. from Detroit to Louisville to Wilmington, Ohio. And that was one of the first stories that got me thinking differently about civic culture in America, was talking to these two misfits in Wilmington, Ohio. And after 10,000 jobs were slashed from their local community around the time of the financial crisis, they decided to just stay in Wilmington, in their hometown, and they built out, they were 25, 26, they built out basically a Peace Corps model for bringing local economic development to that small town. And I think that was really powerful. You know, many of their peers were chasing success in New York or Philadelphia. And so for them to have that strong place-based identity, to not just be these consumers of place, but to actually actively produce the types of things they wanted to see in their small town was really inspiring. And being on this bus tour, we met so many amazing, you know, grassroots characters that just had these rich personalities that were doing amazing things that you don't hear about, you know, in a lot of traditional reporting.
Great. I'd love to hear another story from that trip, and it may be a particular person that you met.
Well, first of all, the bus was an old Barbara Mandrell, I don't know if you guys know, the country singer, like tour bus, which was amazing. So, and a little bit silly. So we went around the country in this. We left from Austin. We went through New Orleans, through the Deep South, and then up through Baltimore. We were in Baltimore the day that the peace rallies were happening. So after the curfew was just repealed, and that was incredible to just see the way in which the national news reported Baltimore versus seeing what was actually going on, and how people in the city were really, you know, taking responsibility for what was happening and self-governing and protecting against looting and this type of thing. Detroit to me was also incredible. I know we met just so many amazing artisans doing work in Detroit. And I think I'd always been really nervous about being a sort of outsider or foreigner who wanted to sort of live the Wild West moment that is Detroit. And I think the bus tour had me reflect a lot around the role of outsider identity, particularly going into communities. But it was really in Mobile, Alabama, where I started thinking differently about the role of outsiders, because I think so many small towns can be like incumbent companies in a lot of ways, where the outsider can potentially destabilize the sort of power dynamics or the cultures of the towns. Enough so that, you know, fresh ideas and people that have maybe been disenfranchised from the power of those towns can actually come in. And so that's been really interesting to understand the role of, you know, well, who's acting as a shepherd in these towns versus how do we actually create more horizontal networks across the U.S. for civic innovation to really scale.
Great. So in some ways, what would a vibrant misfit sector, is that a signal of a good change, or is that a signal that something's wrong with the system and wrong with the structure of opportunity?
I think, yeah, it's responding to a dysfunction, I think. You know, I think we do need to, there's so many challenges that we're facing. I mean, we were speaking about climate change earlier and what you guys are trying to do in building, you know, this new challenge for entrepreneurs. But I think the level of transformation that we need at, you know, with various issues is just enormous. And so that requires a call to action for misfits, for more deviant style behaviors, and also to work across silos. You know, this problem can't be solved by one entrepreneur within one institution developing a venture that is tied to that institution. You know, it needs to be happening in these third places. We need more sort of pre-competitive collaborations where, you know, companies get together and pool resources, or we need these types of third places in cities where, you know, civic innovators can actually get together. It really requires a completely rewired type of citizenship too. I think so much of our citizenship now is dependent on this idea of the consumer self. You know, we outsource our agency as citizens often just through democracy in the form of a vote. It's incredible to me how political candidates can do all this mobilization around voting where there's not a greater call to action. You know, how are our leaders asking us to participate in civic culture? And so for me, the bus tour was really refreshing in actually discovering all these citizen actors, all these misfits who, you know, aren't just plugged into like a dry political discourse, but are taking these actions locally. And so that becomes interesting. How do we spark misfits to be able to express more of their agency in the world?
I have to ask about the group in Paris that breaks into civic buildings to repair artifacts, or not even artifacts, but items of culture that are being just ignored by, I guess, budgets, essentially. Tell us more.
Yeah, so, I mean, there's this great sort of parkour community as well as like underground explorer community around the world. And one in particular that we spoke to was this underground hacker collective called UX, which is based in Paris. And their most famous thing was breaking into the Pantheon and restoring a antique clock, basically, that they thought was being neglected by the government. And, you know, their mission was really to restore the forgotten artifacts of French civilization. And so it was interesting to think of, you know, to see this hacker collective, far from being, you know, a sort of scary or threatening with a hacker ethos, was actually doing something for the public good. And in addition to that, they throw, you know, film festivals and the tunnel systems. Everyone has a normal day job. So they have completely anonymous identities when they go underground. So this to me is really fascinating.
And the project took months.
Oh, totally. Yeah. Yeah, and they had, I mean, to even do the break-in, right? Like, they have elaborate knowledge of how to break into buildings and, you know, in Paris of the underground tunnel system, which is, you know, illegal to even go into.
They brought a refrigerator with them?
Yeah. It was really impressive. But it was also, to me, it was so interesting because it was really normal people. It was people that went to 9-to-5 jobs and then had basically these alter egos that were much more stealthy and clandestine, who could basically do these types of acts. And so that got me really interested in this spirit of provocation. Another group that we spoke to in France was this amazing group called La Barbe that's basically were like the Yes Men. They were basically these pranksters, French feminists, that anytime they would go to an event, not this one because this one is quite diverse, but events that were too male dominated, they would basically wear these fake mustaches and congratulate the men on basically being men and how much they had achieved, you know, through their masculinity. And, you know, that type of action was just, you know, fantastic to see. And it really broadened my own canvas. You know, I think before, success for me always looked like starting a venture. And it got me thinking differently in terms of, oh, I can actually just take an interventionist approach to the type of change that I'm trying to create. It doesn't always need to be this grand blueprint for, you know, a new sort of social social venture, or have to plug into a traditional organization, but it can be in the spirit of pranking.
Great. We have some young people here with us today, and you mentioned that one of the reasons for writing the book is to create an alternative narrative around innovation, that we shouldn't just be looking to the tech founders of Silicon Valley. For many young people, especially here in the Bay Area, someone like Mark Zuckerberg is probably a role model. Mm-hmm. Is the suggestion that instead that they should look to the informal economy, maybe even criminals or pirates?
Well, I don't know if you were a lot of like white kids in San Francisco just sort of like heroizing gangsters. But I think the point is that probably already happens. I think the point is to sort of Steve Jobs, like I would put in a similar category to Zuckerberg, like, you know, the fact that they have so much idolatry like built around them, I think is really dangerous. I think, how do we expand our idea, especially for kids, of, you know, how do we contribute to the world? It shouldn't just be creating a new tech startup. You know, we can contribute to the world in so many different ways. And so I think I would want those kids to be exposed to all these different types of people who are modeling, you know, misfit behaviors and trying to transform and change society. And that can't be done, you know, through a startup. Maybe that's just like one avenue for that. But, you know, the people who are really rebuilding their small towns, or people that are creating, you know, these collectives, or people that are looking at lobbying against a specific policy. I think there are just so many different ways in which people can take the road less traveled. And I think it's really dangerous, this kind of copycat entrepreneurship, where people are really sort of plugged into a formula of success that someone else has created. At the same time, you know, we wouldn't want to just say this is the misfit path and, like, you know, walk this carbon copy.
Though it could be argued that Zuckerberg at least started as a misfit, and maybe Steve Jobs too.
Yeah, I think they definitely both have a little bit of misfit DNA, for sure. And a lot of great, you know, Richard Branson, you know, has that as well. And he's spoken a lot about how even his learning disabilities contributed to a lot of his entrepreneurial success. But similarly, like, why, you know, these people aren't prophets, you know, what worked for them shouldn't be a formula that someone else follows.
Great. In that same vein, we have a question from the audience, and I think it might be one of the students that's here. The question is, how can our schools encourage this deviant and entrepreneurial behavior? And really interesting to think about schools encouraging deviant behavior when they might be thought of as institutions that are meant to enforce rules.
Yeah, I mean, I went to a lot of alternative schools, so I have good experience at creating deviants at school. One thing, so we had a town meeting system where students basically got to determine the rules of the schools through participatory democracy. I used that in a way to create a pillow room at the school, where one room was just full of pillows and students could go there whenever they wanted. So you had little things like that that were a little bit silly, but then on the other hand, you also had students who called teachers by their first names. You had students learning philosophy and designing their own curriculum as adolescents, which was enormously empowering. And I think, you know, there are a lot of people, even entrepreneurs within the educational system, that are trying to bring much more, you know, cultures of self-directed learning, of bringing unschooling practices into traditional educational environments. And I think teachers need support with that too, because teachers don't have, the time to always scan and look at the latest models of disruptive educational methods. But, you know, when I was a student, I remember being in, you know, a normal public school where I felt like a commodity. And I know what it feels like to have teachers who look and deeply acknowledge who you are and, you know, your own sort of special authenticity. And that made all the difference in, you know, my education and being able to pursue paths that worked for me and weren't based on some formula.
Where I work, we talk at IDEO a lot about fostering creative confidence and also in using design thinking as a way to have a problem-solving and optimistic view of the world. Are we actually misfits and we didn't realize it?
Yeah, I mean, so creative what are the sort of lessons in creative confidence?
Sure. You know, I think many is just recognizing that we all are creative and that we're often holding back our creativity for a variety of reasons and often things that are taught or learned rather than, you know, you think of a kid as being intuitively creative and willing to take those risks. But that much of the impact that we could have on the world is through our creativity if we can believe in ourselves and also have the almost the repetition or the muscle memory to do it.
Yeah, I think that's incredible. I mean, there is a complete sort of, I would say, a sort of silencing that happens. You know, similar to this idea that everyone has an inner misfit, it's maybe the idea that everyone has an inner artist to some mm-hmm. extent. And yet for so many people that is really numbed through a lot of traditional education. And so, you know, how do you bring that out? And I think, I was just at the Aspen Ideas Festival and it was incredible to go from these rooms. I remember hearing one poet speak about the work that she was doing and there was just so much emotional embodiment in that conversation. And to really think about the role of a poet in creating social change, the role of an artist in creating social change, and then going into a different room that's about civic innovation and urban cities, and just the level of flatness, the level of like emotional disembodiment that is part of those conversations is really interesting. And I think even the social change sector in many ways has been taken over by more sort of rationalist functionaries or even by the persona of the social entrepreneur, which in many ways is for certain people is a martyr identity. I remember when I worked at Ashoka, so many people felt like they were, you know, really burning out on social change. And so that's not really sustainable either.
Oh, that's fascinating. Yeah, do you think of social entrepreneurs as being, they're burning out because they're so dedicated and it's so hard to start something new?
Yeah, I mean, any misfit, really, you're going against the grain, right? And so that's incredibly personally taxing. It requires a lot of resilience. And so we spend the last part of the book really looking at this resilience question and how do you, if you're going against norms within society, how do you stay strong? How do you stay, energetic within that? And you do need this entourage of support. And I don't think it's that all, you know, certainly not all social entrepreneurs have this martyr identity, but you're making enormous sacrifice for something bigger than yourself. And there's been a lot of programming now that has got, you know, looked at some of the therapeutic interventions with social entrepreneurs. Like, why are you sacrificing so much of your sort of emotional self and personal life for this bigger cause? And is that always the best thing, you know, that you can be doing? I think, you know, both my parents definitely walked more of a misfit path, and I feel like firsthand I saw the taxing nature of that, but also something that I thought was, you know, worth that commitment.
Is that part of what inspired you to do this book?
I think so, yeah. Yeah, I mean, my mom researched alien abduction for a period of time, so she was traveling around the world talking to people who thought they had been abducted by aliens, which was fascinating and very scary when I was 8 years old. to feel like, maybe there are aliens that exist, you know, as you're trying to distinguish between fantasy and reality. But then part of me was also very upset that I had never been abducted myself because I thought I should be the ambassador of the human race. And, you know, I think through her research, she was definitely pushing the boundaries of, you know, mainstream sort of Western consciousness in a lot of ways. And she worked for this guy, John Mack, who ran psychiatry at Harvard and won a Pulitzer Prize for his, he did a psychoanalytic biography of Lawrence of Arabia, built out a lot of psychological theories around childhood development, And then all of a sudden later in his career started getting all these patients who claimed to be abducted by aliens. And so for him, this was really a complete rabbit hole in his professional career where he had to take a chance and risk his reputation. And he was really ostracized. People at Harvard tried to get him fired. He lost a lot of his, a lot of support, but he also found interesting new allies. You know, people came out of the woodwork to really rally around his cause. And, you know, my dad similarly was someone who grew up super poor on a small town in Missouri, got a scholarship to Harvard, and, you know, rather than sort of plugging into traditional sort of corporate or, you know, institutional jobs, built out some of the first fair trade markets. So he created Reinforced Crunch with Ben and Jerry's and did a lot of work on certification and fair trade movements. And so I think both of them in different ways opened up what was possible in life and showed me, you know, both had enormous conviction and courage to sort of do things a little bit differently.
It's interesting to note that not all misfits are successful and, you know, like all entrepreneurs, the failure rates is probably very high,
yeah.
Except that for other entrepreneurs and maybe social entrepreneurs, there's still maybe a lot to gain through failure, whereas for misfits, maybe more is at stake. If they fail, maybe it is being ostracized from their community or shame or, you know, being punished for breaking the law.
Yeah, I think there is something that can be sort of alienating for sure because you're walking, I think even within entrepreneurship, you mm-hmm. have a tribe of entrepreneurs. Failure is something that is accessible. If you're really taking your own misfit journey, there's no one necessarily who is there, you know, making you feel like you're part of a bigger community or a bigger tribe. But I think also there's a risk too that you overdose on that feeling of isolation. You shouldn't be content with being this like lonely, misunderstood outsider type figure. I think many misfits, what the work that they have to do is actually figuring out how to build communities of support around their ideas and how to infect mainstream institutions with a lot of their thinking. And that takes time, and it doesn't always get activated right away. Like, it's interesting to see the way in which people talk about Buckminster Fuller today, you know, and like he's like this new sort of resurgent hero, but you know, people are not always celebrated in the time period, and this is true of, you know, tons of wonderful misfit artists and writers as well.
It's interesting that the whole idea of having communities of misfits and the power of that entourage.
Yeah.
You talk a little bit about Burning Man and the Burning Man community as being a powerful misfit community that's really been strengthened by their ability to share a collective experience.
Yeah, there was, we talk a little bit about a lot of festival culture and this group that I started, Wisdom Hackers, which was really a peer-to-peer community for people to explore burning questions. So there was this idea that in normal everyday life, we're caught up in the hustle and flow and we don't have time to really ask ourselves the big philosophical questions that we all hold. And so how do we foster, give ourselves permission to even do that? And then how do we foster accountability with others or create a community for those, you know, who are long out of school to actually begin to explore that? And so one of the questions that someone asked within this collective was, how do we keep festival spirit alive in everyday life? And I think so many people can have these transformative experiences. You know, oftentimes they do talk about them in spiritual terms, whether it's at Burning Man or in the middle of the jungle somewhere, in the Amazon, and you come back from that experience and you can't integrate it. And I remember reading about Henry Thoreau and after he did his great transcendentalist, you know, experiment and had all this amazing, epiphany, he basically went and worked at his family's pencil factory. And so, you know, I think that's the question for all of us. You know, once we have insight into a different kind of world, how do we actually infect the institutions around us? And I think, you know, Burning Man, you see ways in which Burning Man culture is beginning to spill over, you know, positively in certain ways into mainstream society. But for many, it's really different. Being in the office is fundamentally different than being at a festival.
So we'll switch gears a little bit with some questions from the audience. So going all the way from the fringe in some ways of festival culture to the centers of power, the question is about how can we connect this new movement with our politicians and government?
Yeah, I think that's great. I think this is, when I think about the work that I do, it's often around this idea of culture hacking. So how do we work with people within incumbent power systems, but then how do we also work with disenfranchised, marginalized grassroots community, and how do we begin to sort of weave some of these groups together? So from my perspective, the whole entrepreneurship focus has been around this change from within agenda. And that was something that I worked on for 7 years to grow this guerrilla movement of people within huge power systems who were working to transform those institutions from the inside. And that takes a very specific, you know, skill set. I think you do have to camouflage yourself a bit, as I said. You have to learn how to navigate the politics of those organizations. You have to be incredibly patient. Success also often looks like other people taking ownership or taking credit for your ideas, because that means it's actually, you know, sticking within that organization. So I think, you know, within governments and powerful institutions like this, there should also be more of a focus on entrepreneurship. Who are you looking to bring into these institutions? I remember when we were launching the League of Entrepreneurs, we were approached by a lot of people in government and were operating within traditional bureaucracies that didn't necessarily have ways of importing innovation into those agencies, or even in tapping the potential misfit ideas of government bureaucrats, which actually did exist. You know, there were often cases where employees had fantastic ideas and there wasn't really a process for those to develop as ventures.
So following on that, another question from the audience, and I'll follow up with another thought as well, which the question is, how can we channel these misfit entrepreneurial and leadership qualities into the more formal economy and out of crime? I'll follow on it by asking, what's the home run here? Is if you could make some magical things happen and create change that would be really exciting in terms of taking what's great about the misfit movement and translating it into real world change, what does that look like to you?
I guess the thing that has me most concerned at the moment is this idea that we all live in these different bubbles. And I think in doing the research for the Misfit Economy, what was really transformative, I mean, the book just completely hijacked my life for 3 years in a really positive way, but also just, yeah, it was its own rabbit hole. But I suddenly got to meet and build social capital and build friendships and build alliances with people that I never would have otherwise. Like, it really got me out of my usual networks of, like, you know, whatever Ivy League alumni associations and colleagues or people that were heavily curated. And I think that interests me, because I think particularly in the US at this moment, there isn't really a civic culture. There isn't really this common social fabric that we can all draw upon. And people do feel incredibly isolated, or people, you know, I maybe talk to a Republican like once a year. And so I think it's really important to get out of those kinds of communities and begin to spark these, you know, at our book launch, the fact that, like, Freeway Rick Ross, who is a big time cocaine dealer from California, was there, you know, dancing with a friend of mine that went to Brown, and there was maybe some mutual voyeurism there, but it was also the first step in actually having people build understanding and empathy who were from completely different communities. So I think that's kind of the focus, is how do we, this is a book, sure, but how does this also become an invitation towards creating more mashups and creating more of a social fabric between really diverse communities? And for me, the Misfit umbrella is something that can do that, because it's an identity that resonates with the disenfranchised, with the bohemian, with the startup founder. It's something that we can use that sort of unites everyone.
So it's not just the entourage for an individual misfit or a community of misfits, but in some way there's something that connects people across disciplines or across focus areas based upon this idea of we're breaking some rules and that's okay, but we're pursuing change that's exciting for some reason.
Yeah, I mean, I think, so what is it about the misfit identity? I think fundamentally a lot of human beings that I've spoken to, and I certainly feel this, have this sense of fallenness. We are born into cultures that we did not design ourselves. Whether you talk to someone who works at Exxon or you talk to someone who is part of like a street gang, and there are things that are deeply alien about the societies that we are born into, and people want to change that. People want to have greater agency to imprint their values on the world. And I think that is a common struggle that unites, you know, misfits, but really just human beings.
But also maybe people in power or people that are not misfits, but maybe share that same view.
Yeah.
So it's almost that there needs to be connection, not just between misfits, but between misfits and the formal sector as well.
Yeah, definitely.
So another question from the audience, will a college education be as valuable in a world where informal economies dominate throughout the U.S.?
I mean, I think it's already, I think college education is already being devalued in many, many ways, because I think the skill sets that we need now more than ever are not necessarily taught in college. You know, that being said, I had an amazing college experience that I think did prepare me for a very transitional economy. And so I really think it depends on the skills and attributes of each person individually and what they're trying to do. I think this idea that everyone should go to college is misguided. I think it's really interesting what, you know, the growth of apprenticeship schools and that coming back into vogue is fascinating. And then the unschooling movement, which is to say, you know, there are all these kids who have these amazing interests who want to follow their own passions and don't want to plug into formal institutions. And actually learning those skills of self-directed learning can prepare you more for an entrepreneurial path than learning how to be the cog in an educational system. So I wouldn't say there's one, you know, sort of writ large answer for that. I think some of the experimentation too with like online education is a poor substitute for actual learning. Like this idea that we should outsource higher learning to like a Coursera entirely just eclipses wisdom for me. Like what I've learned, it hasn't been through like an online transactional experience, but it's through like depth of conversation and depth of immersive experience.
Great. So we have a question from a misfit, from Josh. So the question is, in the study of misfits in many countries and throughout time, is there anything different about the modern version of a misfit?
That's really interesting. I think maybe the challenges facing, in some ways, I think we can be misfits now more than ever because a lot of societal barriers that used to exist have been removed. It was interesting to just, you know, do research on like Helena Wright, for example, who was an early pioneer of family planning and had this sex positive attitude in the UK. And, you know, someone like her faced enormous challenge in trying to get her ideas socialized within the system. And today, you know, that wouldn't even be a question. But I do think there are barriers to sort of misfit identity that exist now that, you know, didn't necessarily exist in the past. And one is bureaucracy. David Graeber just wrote a fantastic book on the nature of bureaucracies. And I think these kind of huge levelless institutions disable us in many ways from bringing a lot of our own sort of misfit instincts and ideas and our own you know authenticity into what we do. You also have enormous responsibility dumping that happens in bureaucracies. So it's the situation, you know, anything from like an oil spill to the financial crisis where there's no one culprit. You know, it's kind of this benign system that is creating this atrocity in some ways. And I think, you know, I think that's really a challenge for people. And also this experience of alienation, you know, the rise of more sort of digital tech and those sorts of platforms, as well as, you know, the sort of liberal pathways that people are following from, you know, this idea of success being, you know, disembedding from the community that you're from and going to the city and, you know, taking a job and having that sort of dictate your existence means that people are more isolated and alienated than they have been in the past. And so I think that creates both a need for acknowledgement, which is maybe part of, you know, why this is a powerful label right now, where people don't necessarily feel like they're part of these organizations or institutions. So those are a few things that I feel like are really, you know, more modern drivers of why, like, this Misfit label is popular right now.
You talk a bit of in the book about going out onto one's own, or having a journey and having that distance from wherever they're from is creating at least some distance and maybe reflection that pushes them into a misfit category or path. But in some ways you're saying that modernity creates enough alienation that maybe we all have that tendency, even if we don't have to physically go somewhere.
Yeah, I think it's, I wouldn't conflate alienation and hermit time. So we talk about the power of hermits a little bit in the book, and particularly this experience of attunement, you know, of really listening to your own intuition and instincts that can help you, you know, figure out what it is that you really want to do in life and what kind of legacy that you want to have. And, you know, it's interesting to see the digital detox experiences that a lot of, like, tech founders and entrepreneurs are embracing. You know, these getting off the grid type things. A friend of mine who started what eventually became a startup spent a year just living on an island off the coast of Seattle with two other people, thinking about, well, what is it that we want to bring into the world? And I think there are ways in which that kind of isolation, you know, has historically really inspired people too, in terms of thinking about zooming out. There was a sort of fake article that I did ages ago in Fast Company that was about how to cosmos proof your startup, which was basically this long now kind of argument for how do we think within longer time horizons about the things that we do. And, you know, what are the bigger contributions that we want to make? And I think that requires you to not just, like, look at, scan the market, but really, you know, search yourself internally.
Great. Another question from the audience. Are there any major examples of top-level innovators who are not misfits? Could this be a distinction without difference?
Top-level innovators who are not misfits.
This is from Eric, who says he's from Twitter.
I don't know. I mean, I kind of think in some ways, like, a sort of German personality of, like, an engineer comes to mind, where it's, like, pure play, like, a sort of, like, efficiency innovation. But, yeah, I don't know if they're – I mean, it depends, I guess, on what you're calling innovation. Yeah, I think it's a fascinating question. I could see the role of someone mainstreaming or scaling an innovation who is not a misfit, but that's different. Like, thinking about pure play disruption,
a separation between a distinction between entrepreneurship and innovation is that you can probably be successful at helping grow a business or grow some sort of organization, but you're not necessarily innovative.
If
you are being innovative, then, you know, maybe there is some element of being a misfit.
I think, and it could just be a reporting problem too. There are probably, maybe there's a disruptive innovator who, you know, there was someone behind the scenes who was actually the misfit genius behind that, and they took credit. But yeah, I really can't think of a sort of cog personality who was key to a particular disruptive innovation.
Thank you.
If anyone has an idea there, that would be amazing to hear.
I love this next question. Human societies are built on fitting in. How can we handle this paradigm shift? Societies of this scale probably need some sort of fitting in.
Yeah, I think that's exactly right. I think a lot of communities are built on fitting in. And I think it's interesting, too, the ways in which capitalism has basically created ideas of consumers where we've all had to sort of internalize basically a mass kind of aggregate identity. I was really interested. I used to study economic history, and so I became really fascinated with this idea of self-fashioning as the new sort of liberal market economic system was being created, because during this time there were actually conduct manuals that instructed people how to behave within this new you know, economy, like how to be good entrepreneurs and how to have these virtues of moderation and rationality and sort of really preach this level of like self-interested individualism. And so, you know, what would that conduct manual look like today? Like, what would a conduct manual for misfits look like? And I think, you know, in many ways, this is something that I'm doing with different groups. We're actually building curriculums for human agency and for people, black sheep, and for, you know, this more sort of deviant approach to personality. And that's not to provide like one particular formula. But I think we're realizing that actually human beings are capable of interacting, and like the depth of therapeutic intervention that's happened in the last 50 years has been really interesting, where we can actually all be contained as very different, diverse people, where where your difference doesn't threaten my difference, and we can actually be within similar spaces. I think we have evolved so much psychologically in that direction for that to happen. I think it's possible, and I think it's about the sort of therapeutic revolution that we've been on, as well as creating, you know, the right forms, the right kinds of environments for that to happen.
I'd love to go deeper. You're mentioning just the evolution of therapeutic intervention, and you mentioned previously that you have some background in studying postmodernism and intellectual history. So this, in sort of that big picture of intellectual history and development of thought, where does this fit, and where do we go from here?
Where does Misfit fit within a big history of intellectual thought? Yeah. Wow. Okay.
Is this an example of postmodernism? Is it?
No. I think it's in. So one of the most interesting, well, the books that I thought was super interesting that I read early on was Charles Taylor's Sources of Self. How do we internalize different scripts of what it means to exist? And I think, you know, since the beginning of time, our consciousness has evolved, our subjectivity has deeply evolved, so that, you know, to experience shame in the 17th century would look very different than experiencing shame in the 20th century. And then cross-culturally, you know, that sort of emotional intelligence would also look very different. I think what I learned sort of with more postmodern theory was that we shouldn't just strap like one sort of meta narrative on history where we believe in like the singularity or we believe in like a Marxist idea of history. But, you know, I think the sort of postmodern premise was actually, you know, how do we allow and enable all these different types of cultures to exist on their own terms? I think there has been a deepening of self. I think there was this way in which people used to know themselves through external forces, through myth or through gods, and gradually we came to develop interior selves, right? So like if you look at the 17th century literature around the economy, there's very much this preoccupation with self-interest and with inspecting the self, that people are actually developing practices of individualism that didn't previously exist, where maybe your identity used to be inherited from a religious group or from a community, or, you know, from myth, that now you are actually fashioning yourself on these individual values. And Adam Curtis did a beautiful documentary which shows how that fashioning was not an authentic fashioning, but people were actually given a commodified idea of what it meant to be an individual. So if anything, I think the like misfit thing is meant to dislodge that idea. You know, certainly a lot of the cultures that we and people that we spoke to were not necessarily these personas of like rugged individualists. They were operating within communities and really challenged a lot of that idea of like that traditional entrepreneur who's completely disembedded from a context. Right. That's a really difficult question. Yeah.
Sorry. I'll continue the vein of it, which was that this the part B, which I know you're not a futurist, but where, like, given the trajectory, where do we go from here? What does this lead to?
So I think futurists are really funny because I think futurists just sort of project their own personality onto the future often for whatever they want to have happen. So I developed this alter ego actually called the Amish futurist, where I took someone who'd never been exposed to like the future, not really exposed to technology, and just had them wander around and like make these predictions about the future. So in a way, to not answer that question, this, I think that alter ego experience was really interesting. And it was something that I also brought into the startup conversation of, you know, wearing this bonnet and dressing as this Amish woman and talking to startup founders and asking them really Socratic questions around the meaning behind what they were doing and why they were creating that app and what was the impact of, you know, that technology on our subjectivity, on our sense of well-being, on, you know, how is that changing intimacy or human relationships, and just how do we think more existentially and intentionally about tech creation? I mean, I'm less interested in like predictive futures. I've also just been studying live action role playing for the last month, and I'm doing a piece on it, which I think is really interesting as a way of potentially prototyping futures. I don't know if anyone here has LARPed before. One, amazing. But I think it's a powerful way. It's not just like an activity of nerds running around in the woods with swords, but it can actually be this way where we can temporarily create the conditions for us to live out different realities, right? So if I want to know what it's like to work within a different financial system, let's create a game around that where we, for 2 days, I can experience what that's like. Or if I want to know what a world without like monogamy is like, let's do that for like 2 hours and see what that would look like. So I think those type of situations where we're not sort of dealing with distant futures, but we're actually being able to participate and bring futures closer that we might want to live in and prototype them rather than just have these master blueprints of what we think the future should have in store.
Right. We're all for prototyping. An interesting question from Chris is there any connection that you see between personality disorders, say narcissism, and innovation?
Ooh, yeah. I think that's interesting. I always think whenever I'm doing a project too, and I have like a little tug of the ego, I always think that the ego is the thing that's protecting the project, that somehow the idea is using human ego for itself to be realized. And I think often, like, maybe we can sort of reframe narcissism as a way for that idea to be using and hijacking that person to come into being in the world. So that's a weird sort of frame that I did myself, which I guess apologizes somewhat for the narcissists. But yeah, we've definitely, you know, a lot of progressos to narcissistic behavior, unfortunately. Yeah.
I want to try to get through another couple of questions. As a student at a high school or college, how can I bring social change, support new entrepreneurial spirits and ideas and impact in the way that within the formal structure of the school?
Yeah, I think so many, I spent a lot of time at Ashoka working with social entrepreneurs. And I think the biggest thing that catalyzed a lot of them to do the work that they're doing is just working with the pain points that they discovered in everyday life. And I think the biggest difference that a social entrepreneur has with versus kind of everyone else is the fact that rather than just experience a problem individually or feel the pain of something individually, they're able to see that problem that they're experiencing as a problem that as a systems problem. So if you're dealing with a mental health issue and you're finding it hard to navigate, you know, that system of care, that's not just a problem that you're facing individually. That's a problem that actually a lot of people are facing. And so social entrepreneurs, it's not that you sort of get knighted by some external force. It's often that you're encountering these problems that are just happening in your communities or to your friends or to you that you feel like you want to design an intervention around. And I think it's just being open enough to sort of explore that problem, to invite people in, to have a conversation around, well, what are some of the things we could do with that problem? It's very, it's just a very simple thing.
Mm-hmm. Tell us about the wisdom hackers.
Yeah, so I mentioned wisdom hackers a little bit as this incubator for philosophical inquiry. And for me, this owed to a former high school teacher that I had who was one of the most influential people in my life, and, you know, took us to the caves of West Virginia and dressed up as Socrates and reenacted Platonic dialogues and just equipped me with this, as a young woman, especially with the power of just, you know, philosophical probing, which basically gives you a currency to talk to anyone from like the misfit on the subway to like someone in a financial institution who's having an existential crisis about what they're doing. You know, so I think Wisdom Hackers was really bringing that spirit of a philosophical perspective back into everyday life. So many of us increasingly are, you know, existing outside of spiritual traditions within secular culture. How do we create meaningful secular community around, you know, pretty basic questions that relate, you know, fundamentally to the pursuit of wisdom? And how do we actually spend time to do that? So that was the exploration. It was 15 of us initially who started. Each person explored a different burning question that they held, and I worked one-on-one with each person to really figure out what that question was. And then we spent 8 weeks each going deeply into that question, talking to strangers, talking to grandparents, talking to each other, and it really provided some peer-to-peer support for doing that kind of excavation. And then we held a number of salons globally to bring other people into that learning process. And so now Wisdom Hackers is really just functioning as a open source brand in a lot of ways, where anyone can run with it to do a salon, to teach a course on wisdom hacking, to run their own group. I'm launching a project with a friend where we're doing this incubator for the next Messiah, which is like this kind of satirical play where we're basically designing an accelerator or an incubator to find the next like world guru. And for us, this is a really interesting way of looking at, how do you kind of take this American Idol approach to like the guru industry, but also, and like, what does it mean when you have these methods that have like lean startup, what would that look like applied to like a religious idea or to like an aspiring prophet? And so that's just a riff on these two different cultures that, you know, I see existing and I think would make like funny satirical television, but also placed, you know, will be incubated by the Wisdom Hacker community.
Are you a misfit?
Yeah. Are you?
I hope so.
Okay. Yeah.
How do you keep your misfitness fit? How do you stay misfit? Hang out with the Amish. How do you foster your
definitely
misfit
hanging
DNA?
Out with the Amish. In so many different ways. Yeah, I think like being around other people. I spoke to a lot of performance artists too for this book that inspired me and sort of grew my misfit practice in a way. It's not that conscious, but yeah, I think just hanging out with other people that also, you know, that have incredible courage and passion in what they do. Going into communities that, you know, I wouldn't necessarily go into. I was inspired a lot by, you know, Plain or Amish or Luddite communities and doing some of the work that I'm doing and having a different stance and perspective on technology. Having a supportive entourage too. You know, having people that you can troubleshoot ideas with, people that really see who you are. I think just that being seen and being deeply acknowledged. I think I had so many friends in college where it was all, I think they were more like superficial relationships in so many ways that you're building, you're going out and doing things. And I think in the last 3 years, I've really cultivated a sort of network of friends where we're able to sort of deeply tune in to, you know, who is this person sitting across from me and what are they trying to do in life? And that's incredibly rich and rewarding and makes doing things possible, because then you feel like you're not just doing it as this individual, but you have other people who are supporting you.
Great. Well, some great advice for everyone. I want to thank you.
Thank you.
That's all the time we have tonight. On behalf of the World Affairs Council, I'll ask you in joining me in thanking Alexa Clay for this excellent discussion.
Cool.